Thank you for the invitation. It's great to be in Bristol again. And yeah, so the work was actually done at the Russian Quantum Center that Yuri was also reporting from yesterday. And there'll be also three separate topics, all somehow related to Schrödinger cats, right? So first there'll be an introduction on what Schrödinger cats are. My talk, so it's related to Morgan's talk in the sense that the first half will be actually on noon states that he mentioned, and it's also related to Akira's talk in the sense that we both use hybrid quantum technologies. On the other hand, hybrid continuous variable, of course, Akira is much more advanced than we are. So Akira, I think Akira is going to actually explain what hybrid quantum technologies are, and I'm not. So you have to just sort of believe my results without my explaining how we do the measurements if you don't know about them. So to start with Schrödinger cats, you of course know this story, like what Schrödinger's Gedanken experiment is. And the question that I often ask my students is, why do we actually not see Schrödinger cats around, right? I mean, obviously, mathematically, a superposition of, this kind is just as viable of a state as each element of this superposition taken separately, right? So, but somehow we see elements of this superposition, but we don't see the superposition itself in either plus or minus. And the question is why? And the answer is, exactly, because these elements are visible, right, and they're visibly distinct, that means that the elements of the superposition will instantly entangle themselves with the environment, and then with the rest of the universe, and then the universe will split if you're a multi-world interpretation fan like myself, or if you are a boring Copenhagen person, then you just say that. The macroscopic superpositions quickly decohere, and this is decoherence preferred basis. So each of these two elements of the decoherence preferred basis, and therefore superpositions do not exist. So actually, in 2013, we did a paper showing large macroscopic Schrödinger cat state containing about 100 million photons. But I'm not going to talk about this. What I am going to talk about now is. Yeah, so until about 20 years ago, that was a pure Gedanken experiment. I think Schrödinger himself did not believe that it would ever become part of experimental physics. But then, recently, we became able to construct these states in practice. And what we mean by Schrödinger cats, usually in quantum optics, is not this complex entangled state, although sometimes we do, but most frequently, it's just a superposition of macroscopically distinct states. So here, just dead cat, the superposition of a dead cat and a living cat. And now we can produce such states in many systems, like in superconducting circuits in microwaves and in optics, right? And these states are relevant for both fundamental and applied questions. So fundamentally, of course, they help answering one of the few yet unanswered questions of modern physics, namely, at which degree of macroscopicity, at any, does quantum mechanics stop, you know, being functional, and does quantum physics take over, right? If there is, there's either such a point, right, or if there is no such point, if quantum mechanics is universal, then we would have to accept the many world. Right, no alternative to these two. And furthermore, Schrödinger cats have a lot of applied usage in quantum information science, for quantum teleportation, quantum computation, and so on. I won't elaborate on this. So in optics, what is a Schrödinger cat in optics? It's a superposition of two coherent states of opposite phases. Right, because coherent states are considered to be classical and they also can be macroscopic. So coherent states of opposite phases are therefore Schrödinger cat-like states. And well, if you think of it, what's the physics of it? The physics of it is that electric field vectors in the Schrödinger cat state are pointing in both directions at the same time. It's really cool, right? Yeah, and well, this is the Wigner function of that state, so you can see that there are two humps corresponding to individual coherent states, right? And then there is this non-classical feature, interference, something that looks like interference fringes, that corresponds to the to this being a superposition. If this were not a superposition, if this were, they were not definitely plus or minus, then we would just see the two humps. If we just had a mixture of alpha and minus alpha, we would just see two humps, and this state is easy to produce. This state is a highly non-classical state and it's difficult to produce. Right, so that makes me brings me to my next question, how to make a Schrödinger cat. And actually for a small amplitude, for small alpha, it's quite easy because look, if we look at coherent states alpha and minus alpha, they will have the same coefficients in front of the even Fock states, but opposite coefficients in front of the odd Fock states. Yeah? So if we add two coherent states, then what remain is just even states, something that looks like this. And if we subtract them, then we just get odd states. Right? Mm-hmm. And that already tells us kind of how to produce this, because this state here looks very much like a squeezed vacuum state. And this state here is also almost a squeezed vacuum state, but with a subtracted single photon component. And that's how exactly we do it. So the first person to do it was, first group to do it was the group of Grandjean. So what you do is you subtract the photon. How do you subtract the photon? You take your state, like a squeeze state in this case, you send it through a very low reflectivity beam splitter, right? And then you look in the reflected channel with the single photon detector. And if the single photon detector clicks, then then you know that the photon has been removed from this state because there is no other way this one would click, right? And then here, if you input a psi, you output a psi, you subtract the photon, right? So you start with a squeezed vacuum, and here's a typo shown before, you start with a squeezed vacuum, you subtract the photon, you get a negative cat state. And that's exactly what people do, right? They have parametric down conversion, generate squeezed light, and then tap off a little fraction, wait for a click here, and then perform homodyne detection, that's what they're doing. So that's not our result, that's Spiridon's result. Right, so that's the end of the introduction, and let's now come to the content of the talk. So the first question I want to answer is how to make a noon state in a lossy environment. So, well, you all know what noon states are. It's like superpositions of n photons being either in one channel or in the other channel. And the special feature of this state, as Morgan said, is that it's highly sensitive to phase shifts. If you put it in the interferometer, you get fringes at a frequency, not at the wavelength that corresponds to the actual wavelength, but the nth fraction of the wavelength, right? And that's therefore it's useful for metrology. The trouble with this state is that it's extremely sensitive to losses. So even small losses will kill the whatever advantage you may have. And then the question that arises, can you actually create a noon state in between parties that are separated by a lossy medium? Right? So if you have a lossy medium, can you somehow, you have this fog between Alice and Bob, can you somehow create a noon state in spite of that fog? And the answer is positive. Maybe I should have made a longer pause. the answer is positive. Here's what you do. Alice and Bob both need to create two mode squeeze states, which is 0, 0, plus 1, 1, plus 2, 2. And then they send modes C and D, so one mode from each two mode squeeze state, into the fog. And then they project these two modes onto the two photon noon state, 2-0 plus 0-2. And the way they do it is they use the inverse Kongo-Mandel effect. They overlap the two on a beam splitter, and then they put single photon detectors, and they wait for clicks in both detectors. So they project these two modes into 1-1, and that means that they are projecting C and D onto a noon state. And because A is the same as C and D is the same as B, that means that A and B are also automatically projected onto a noon state. Yeah, so that's how. And then you create the noon. So basically, that's like entanglement swapping, and that creates your noon state. Right? And then you can verify, you can measure these two by homodyne detectors and verify that it really works. And it does work, so that's the density matrix that we obtain. So you see these red columns is actually what we want. The blue columns is junk that occurs due to losses. But so now I just said that we are not sensitive to losses, and yet we see this junk present to yet we see the effect of losses. So let me emphasize this. Go to the previous picture. We are sensitive to losses in modes A and B. It's only the loss in modes C and D, right? The foggy environment that we are not sensitive to, right? But A and B, outside of the fog, we are still sensitive, and we still see the effect of that. But we don't see any effect of the loss in mode C and D. In our case, we have a factor of 10 loss, right? Then we do the usual stuff, like the twofold, like the double sensitivity to phase, enhanced sensitivity to the phase. We see that, so I think that one of these two curves is obtained in the presence of the loss, the other one in the absence of the loss in mode C and D, and you can see that the picture is exactly the same, so we really are not sensitive to the loss if we have this involved, right? And another feature I'd like to emphasize is that usually the way people envision to apply the noon state is that they would need to combine the two channels of the noon state. Eventually they would need to be combined on a single interferometer, and then you need to count the photons at the output of the interferometer. And we say it's not really necessary, because what you can do instead is you can use these homodyne detectors here, and these homodyne detectors, if Alice and Bob have a good synchronized clock, that these homodyne detectors actually are sufficient to take the advantage of the noon state. Yeah, now where does Schrödinger cats come in? Actually, it's sort of a collateral result in this experiment, but the idea is that you have this 2,0 plus 0,2. Why don't we, same experiment but interpret it differently, measure the quadrature with just one of the homodyne detectors, right? So you project this 2 onto X quadrature and this 0 here onto the X quadrature. Well, what you get then is a superposition of 0 and 2 with coefficients of the superposition being dependent on the value of the quadrature you observe. And as we discussed, the superposition of 0 and 2 is nothing but an even Schrödinger cat state. So in this case, if you project onto 0, for example, you get a state that looks like this, and it's like it has the amplitude of like, well, close to 2. After correction for all the losses, we have this nasty feature in our experiment that we write in small font that all results are corrected for 45% loss. But if we correct for the 45% loss, 54 transmissivity, we get 1.8 amplitude. Yeah, natural question is, okay, a two photon noon state is nice. Can we do actually more than two photons? And the answer is yes, we can. Just you need a more complicated interferometer in mode C and D, but then it will work very nicely, and you can still realistically at up to 6 photons is possible, and it's analyzed in the supplementary to that paper. Okay, so that's experiment number one. Now experiment number two, teleportation between discrete and continuous variable qubits. Yeah. So as we know in optics, we can encode a qubit in various ways. The most common one is dual rail, a photon being either here or here. One can also encode in single rail. Usual thing, right? When the current is present, it's 0. When the current is not present, it's 1, or the other way. Photon in this case is called single rail optical encoding. And then you can also encode a qubit in a cap, right? You can say that 0 corresponds to the positive coherent state, 1 corresponds to the negative coherent state. And different encodings have different advantages, for quantum repeaters, for example, for other things. And it would be great to have some kind of interface so we can convert between one encoding and the other. And here's exactly the purpose of, this is exactly the purpose of that experiment. So here we teleport a continuous qubit, alpha and minus alpha, onto a single real discrete qubit, 0, 1. And how do we do it? Well, it's a standard Bennett-Broussard scheme. So we have Alice and Bob. Alice starts with this superposition of alpha and minus alpha. Bob, both of them need to share this entangled resource, discrete continuous resource. And then they perform a Bell measurement in the continuous domain. And then Bob gets a copy of the source state, now encoded in the single real qubit, as a single real qubit. So let me now tell you how each element is implemented. In fact, you know, these two have been done already. It's only this that we've done, and the way we've done it is kind of simple, rudimentary, you'll see. So yes, start with the entangled discrete continuous variable resource. That work was done in 2014 by two groups, Bellini and Laurent. If we follow Laurent's method, here's the idea. You have two crystals, right, two down converters. One generates your squeezed light, and again, if you tap off some photon here, send it to a SPCM. If this is SPCM clicks, you get a negative gap. On the other hand, you have a two-mode squeezer, weak two-mode squeezer, which generates pairs of photons. So here, if this one goes onto a SPCM clicks, that means a photon is being present in this channel as well, right? So that's standard heralded photon scheme, right? But now we combine the heralding modes on the same single photon detector, right? And now look what happens. If this guy clicks, we don't know where the photon is coming from. It can be coming either from here, right, and then we get a negative cat here, but no photon here, or it could be coming from here. In this case, we get a heralded photon here, but the positive cat here, right? So we get either negative cat here and zero here, or positive cat here and one here, discrete continuous entanglement. Again, not our work, we only reproduced it, but here you can see that it really works. So here you can see Wigner functions of the continuous channels dependent on what we have in the discrete channel. If it's a vacuum state, then it's a negative cat. If it's a single photon, it's a positive cat. And if it's a superposition, then it's something that looks like a coherent state, as expected. So now the new element, the Bell measurement. So what we need to do is we need to somehow project our two modes onto one of these four states, distinguish these four states from each other, distinguish at least one of them from the other three. How should we do? How can this be done? Well, it's actually not too difficult. Coherent states interfere with each other. If there are two identical coherent states here, then all the light goes to the left, and no light goes to the right. If there are two opposite coherent states, then all the light goes to the right, or no light goes to the left. And that allows us to immediately distinguish phis from the psis, right? If we put a single photon in one of the channels, we distinguish the phis from the psis, right? Because psis, the light will go to the right. Only with phis, the light will go to the left. Right? But moreover, turns out that this procedure also allows you to distinguish the two psis from each other. How so? Because look at this psi minus, look at the result of psi minus after the beam split. You get either a positive cat with the case of psi minus, or a negative cat in the case of psi plus, the other way around. The point is that the positive cat is mostly vacuum. It's squeezed state, but mostly vacuum, right? Negative cat is mostly a single photon state with some admixture of the three photon. Of course, a single photon state is much more likely to generate a click than the vacuum state, right? So a click means more that most likely we have the phi minus, much less likely we have a phi plus. So under our conditions, under the amplitudes that we use, the probability for us that the click means phi plus or phi minus is five times larger than all other cat states. Now, the remaining element of this teleportation experiment is actually preparation of the Schrodinger cat qubit, and again, it was done without before us by Njaagaard Nielsen in Japan, I believe, but not by Akira, right? Somebody else. So here again, he used the tapping procedure, but in addition to sending the tapped photon to a single photon detector, he also sends a weak coherent state there, right? And then this detector doesn't know if it clicks because of a photon from a coherent state or because of the tapped photon. If it's because of the coherent state, then the squeeze state remains intact. If it's because of the squeeze state, then a positive cat becomes a negative cat, so you get a superposition of positive and negative cat. And by changing the amplitude of the coherent state, amplitude of the displacement, and phase, you can generate arbitrary qubits, and that's what they prove very nicely. Now, this is not what we do. Right? What we do is something we've been lazy. We already have two down converters. We are not Janway fans, so we don't want to put in a third down converter in our experiment. So what we did is just we use a weak coherent state, and we argue that the weak coherent state with an arbitrary phase is actually very much like a superposition of coherent states, right? So it's like alpha e power I phi. It looks like this superposition, and then it should teleport accordingly onto a superposition of 0 and 1, right? So this, of course, this is true. This is exactly true for phases equal to 0 and pi, but for other phases you expect lower fidelities. And so here's the scheme of our experiment. This is the preparation of the resource, that's what we already discussed. So we start with the entangled resource, discrete continuous. Then we send our cat, our qubit, into the Bell measurement, perform the Bell measurement, right? And again, this is always rudimentary. You see that it's a rudimentary qubit, rudimentary Bell measurement, not something I'm not the biggest discovery in my research career. So then we do the Bell measurement, and then if this Bell measurement is successful, if we get a click, then Bob performs Fomodyne tomography of the discrete mode output and verifies that the state is what we expect it to be. And indeed it is. So what we plot here is a density matrix of the reconstructed discrete variable state as a function of the phase of the input coherent state. And you can see that it's, here's different colors, but these transparent cubes correspond to diagonal elements of the density matrix. You see that they're always about the same, always a superposition, equal superposition of 0 and 1, but then you have off-diagonal elements that change their phase, right? So in this picture, you can see by blue dot, these red lines, are the phases of input states. The blue dots are the actual reconstructed states, and the length corresponds to the amplitude of the off-diagonal elements. So ideally, it should be on the circle here, but in fact, it's a bit lower. So we don't get perfect fidelity, but still the fidelity on the scale of 80-something%. Thank you. Right, so the final experiment, and that's something I'm really excited about, actually. Something I wanted to do for like at least 12 years. Making Schrodinger cats bigger. So the all methods that we have so far, not just us, like everybody in optics, are only able to generate small Schrodinger cats, right, of small amplitudes. So it would be great to somehow make them bigger, right? Because as I said, right, the bigger we make them, the more macroscopic states become, the more interesting they are for, like, at least fundamental applications, right? And how do we do it? Well, the same technique. Overlap two cats, take two negative cats, overlap them on a beam splitter, and then what you get, as we just discussed, you get a positive cat and vacuum, or a vacuum and a positive cat, this type of superposition. And then all you need to do is to project one of the channels onto a vacuum state, and then the other output will be a positive cat of square root of 2 larger amplitude. Right? So that's the idea. The only trouble is that, well, as the experimentalists here know, it's really difficult to project onto vacuum. So what we instead do is we project onto zero quadrature, and it turns out to be enough, right? Because we want to distinguish a positive cat whose wave function is shown here in red, and the vacuum state whose wave function is in blue, right? So if we get a quadrature value close to zero, that's most likely vacuum. It's less likely the cat, right? And of course, homodyne detection can be done with high efficiency, right? And therefore, the projection is quite good. Yeah, so that's what the experiment looks like, right? So we have these two tapping setups, right? Overlap on the beam splitter, send one channel on a homodyne detector. If this guy shows a small quadrature, then we perform detection in the other channel. So, yeah, it looks easy, but in practice it's quite difficult because of two reasons. First of all, just the number of frequency of events is quite low, right? So each cat is generated with only a small probability, some 10,000 clicks. That means that a double cat is generated with only frequency of 1 hertz, and then there is only a small probability that you get an event here. So it's not perfect. It's much better than our current experiment where we have one event about every 30 seconds or so, but that one I won't tell you about. So, and the second challenge is that you have two phase locks here. One phase lock is here, in this local oscillator to measure the X quadrature, and the other one is here to make sure the two cats are at the same phase. So, and these both locks have to work on the quantum signal, not on the classical signal, and that's not easy. And yeah, so that's the final slide, right? So you can see the result. These are the input cats, again, heavily corrected for the efficiency, but you can see that the input cats very much looks like a single photon state. Well, you know, photon subtracted single photon state with some bells and whistles, right? But this is the output state, and you can see it looks much, much more like a Schrödinger cat I showed in the beginning of the talk, right? It looks much nicer, right? So, and indeed, the amplitude of the cat has increased, in fact, a bit more than a factor of square root of 2. Yeah, so to summarize, I don't have a summary slide, but to summarize, I showed you 3 experiments, right? One is remote preparation of noon states by means of in a lossy environment and using it to prepare cat states. Second experiment, teleportation of a Schrödinger cat qubit onto a discrete variable qubit. And here, an experiment on increasing the amplitude of the Schrödinger cat, and this, of course, can be done iteratively, so that, in principle, should allow us to grow cats of arbitrarily large size. Thank you for listening. When you breed dogs, right, you throw away most of the litter, right, and you select those that have the feature that you're looking for. So in a sense, it is like, but actually, nature didn't like this term either. They said they don't like the ink. The name of the paper should not start with ink. So the nature photonics. So they said this should be something else. Now we call it cultivation of your cat's roots.
Just a quick one, maybe you already explained, but it seems like you can do it iteratively, and I guess the fidelity of that quadrature projection gets better the larger the amplitude. But since you start off with an approximation to a cat that's just the first two or three terms, I guess, does this breeding sort of only work in the limit that the amplitude is still small also, or does it, do you sort of magically approach arbitrarily high order?
It seems that the breeding procedure by itself does not reduce the fidelity by too much. And you see that the initial fidelity was, with the correction for all the efficiency, the one that we start with 93%, we end with 86%, right? So there is some loss of fidelity. So of course, so what's important is that you have a high quality, high efficiency cat, so not much losses. It is less important that you start with a high amplitude. And indeed, the larger cat you have, the larger cat it is, the further you are in the iteration step, the easier it is to select, because then you're, like now our probability is about 1/5, right? But the further away from each other, the further away from each other these two guys are, the easier it is to select, and you end up with a probability 1/2. And yeah, so if you want like cats of size 4, you need this like 10,000 steps, you need to do like 10,000 attempts, which is not too bad.
I wanted to ask a question actually about the mean state generation. So you said six votes on mean states were possible. Was that in practice or in principle?
In principle.
In principle. So have you got a sense of how it might scale?
So in the supplementary there is a calculation. As far as I remember, again, theoretically assuming just a lossy environment and nothing else, no medialities, you have like 300 kilometers for a two-fold unknown state, and then for a six-fold unknown state it becomes like 10 kilometers or so. Well, 10 kilometers is still good, it's quite lively, right? But again, that's the idealized
computation. Any more questions before we do? Okay, I think perhaps there'll be some more questions and discussion over coffee. Let's thank Alex and Morgan.